William Morrow and Harper Audio present Scarface and the Untouchable, Al Capone, Eliot Ness, and the Battle for Chicago by Max Allan Collins and A. Brad Schwartz. Read by Stefan Rudnicki with Max Allan Collins and A. Brad Schwartz. There is something tragically wrong with a system of justice which can and does make criminals of honest men, and can only convict gangsters and racketeers when they don't pay their income taxes. Raymond Chandler.
Introduction. Untouchable Truth by Max Allan Collins. On Monday night, April 20th, 1959, the first of a two-part TV presentation called The Untouchables appeared on Westinghouse Desilu Playhouse. I was 11 years old, watching in Muscatine, Iowa, and I was dumbstruck. The next day, all the kids, well, the boys anyway, were talking about this hard-hitting crime show, the fact-based story of Federal Agent Eliot Ness and his band of incorruptible lawmen taking on the Al Capone gang during Prohibition. Me, I was bowled over by how much it tallied with my obsession, which had started at age 6, with Chester Gould's Dick Tracy, particularly reprints of 1930s and 40s comic strips. When the concluding Untouchables episode aired, finally presenting Al Capone on camera, after the prior week's crafty cliffhanger, I was struck by how much Capone resembled the 30s Tracy villain, Big Boy. I could hardly have imagined that less than 20 years later, I'd be writing the legendary Dick Tracy strip and hearing Chester Gould confirm my suspicions that Detective Tracy had been based on Ness and the Untouchables, a fact still little noted or known. That was the beginning of my interest in true crime in general and Eliot Ness specifically. I immediately read Ness's memoir, The Untouchables, 1957, co-written by sports writer Oscar Fraley, as well as Fraley's follow-up, Four Against the Mob, 1961, about Ness's later law enforcement career in Cleveland, Ohio. The Ness-Fraley book has largely been dismissed as a fabrication, but one of our many discoveries while researching this book has been to confirm how surprisingly accurate it was. Fraley built his narrative on a decidedly non-boastful, fairly short memoir by Ness, amplifying it with newspaper and magazine accounts. But the ghostwriter paid no heed to chronology, and events appeared in what struck Fraley as the most effective order. Ness protested to no avail, taken out by a heart attack at 54, before publication of the work that would make him far more famous dead than he'd been alive. Fraley's readable, if creatively rearranged, account led to a backlash among Ness's contemporaries in law enforcement, as well as Chicago journalists, building him, inaccurately, into a glory hound. The enormously successful TV series spawned by the Desilu Playhouse two-parter did Ness's real-life reputation no favors either. Ironically, the original two-part film, released theatrically as The Scarface Mob, was the most accurate presentation on film Eliot Ness and the Untouchables have ever received. Director Phil Carlson was a master at true crime noir, with The Phoenix City Story, 1955, behind him, and Walking Tall, 1973, ahead of him, with its similar glorification of real-life lawman Buford Pusser. Featuring Hollywood star Robert Stack as a grimly charismatic Ness, The Untouchables two-parter boasted a semi-documentary style, roaring 20s nostalgia, and fast, violent action, with 30s media star Walter Winchell's rat-a-tat-tat narration perhaps the masterstroke. A much fictionalized Chicago mob was amplified by similarly fanciful episodes with Ness taking on such real-life criminals as Vincent Mad Dog Call, Dutch Schultz, Waxy Gordon, Legs Diamond, and Lucky Luciano. J. Edgar Hoover, never a fan of the real Ness, objected so much to the Untouchables' latter-day fame that he insisted the producers credit the FBI's work at the end of the Ma Barker episode. Capone himself, with Brand reappearing, was again featured only in the two-part episode, The Big Train. The only other two-part The Untouchables episode, The Unhired Assassin, was loosely based on the assassination of Mayor Anton Cermak. That event also became the subject of my detective novel, True Detective, 1983. In the late 70s, while teaching mystery fiction at a community college, I happened to notice the Maltese Falcon's 1929 copyright, the year of the St. Valentine's Day Massacre. That meant Sam Spade and Al Capone were contemporaries. Instead of Philip Marlowe meeting an Al Capone type, Al Capone could meet a Philip Marlowe type. In 1981, I set out to write a period private eye story around a real crime, the Cermak assassination. I sought the help of George Hagenauer, a Chicagoan whose knowledge of the city and its mob history was considerable. I said to George, "My private eye, offended by the rampant graft, will quit the Chicago PD." When he stopped laughing, George said, "Max, don't you know? You get on the PD for the rampant graft." In that exchange, Nathan Heller was born. Ever since, George has been my primary research associate on the Heller novels, as well as many other historical thrillers. With Heller, the approach is to research a famous unsolved or controversially solved crime, and when I'm ready to write the definitive work on the subject, I write a private eye novel instead. Early on, I had the idea of making Eliot Ness the honest law enforcement contact for my somewhat shady PI. Every private eye has a cop pal, after all. But I'd read in Fraley that Ness and the Untouchables had disbanded after Capone went to prison, with Ness gone from Chicago by 1933. The mandate of my novel was authenticity, so I abandoned the notion of using him. And then he turned up in the research. Ness was right there on the scene after two corrupt cops attempted the assassination of Frank Nitti, and into True Detective he went. Ness appears in a number of subsequent Heller novels as well. In particular, The Million Dollar Wound, 1986, Stolen Away, 1991, and Angel in Black, 2001. In 1986, I was asked by an editor to spin Ness off into his own novels, a good opportunity to explore his little written about years as public safety director in Cleveland. George and I made several trips to that city and explored the locations of potential Ness novels, from the castle-like boathouse on Clifton Lagoon where Eliot lived, to the dreary Kingsbury Run Gully where the serial-killing mad butcher pursued his homeless prey. Our research took us to the Cleveland Public Library, the City Hall Municipal Reference Library, and the Case Western Reserve Society, where the Ness papers reside. I expected to be disappointed. Noted mob expert Hank Messick's The Silent Syndicate, 1967, explored the Cleveland mob while disparaging Ness's gang-busting role. So when I found in the Case Western Reserve card catalog, remember those, an entry saying, "Eliot Ness Scrapbook," I held out little hope. We'd already been there all afternoon, but asked to see the scrapbook anyway. A civil servant slogged off dutifully to answer our request. Near closing, the civil servant returned, pushing a hand truck laden with perhaps half a dozen huge scrapbooks, each many inches thick and large enough for a newspaper front page of the era to be pasted in. George and I exchanged the same kind of dumbstruck look the original Untouchables broadcast had generated in me. Actually exploring this treasure trove find, apparently the last person to use the scrapbooks had been Oscar Fraley, meant returning the next day, and the next, and many more after that. Examining such items as Ness's eyeglasses and a signed photo, I alerted the staff that this material should not be handed out to the general public, and soon Case Western had put the scrapbooks on microfilm. Among that material were postcards sent from a mental institution to Eliot Ness by the mad butcher of Kingsbury Run. Eerily, the front of one postcard depicted Neville Brand, insane and ranting, clutching prison bars, in a still from Riot in Cell Block 11, 1954, years before Brand would be Al Capone on The Untouchables. My four Ness and Cleveland novels, The Dark City, 1987, Butcher's Dozen, 1988, Bulletproof, 1989, and Murder by the Numbers, 1993, were followed in 2004 by a play, Eliot Ness and Untouchable Life, a one-man show performed by my late friend, Michael Cornelison. Untouchable Life became a film of the same name in 2005, airing on a number of PBS stations. I had written the play and then filmed it, in part because I wanted to go on record with my version of Ness's life. The research George and I did, particularly on Butcher's Dozen, the first book-length work on the Kingsbury Run Slayer, had been plundered without credit by other novelists and graphic novelists and by nonfiction writers who apparently felt that not acknowledging my work was fine because it was fiction. I also wanted to address aspects of director Brian De Palma's 1987 film, The Untouchables. De Palma is a director I admire, and the film is well made and entertaining. The screenplay is another matter. David Mamet certainly created a memorable speech for Sean Connery. You want to get Capone? Here's how you get him. He pulls a knife, you pull a gun, and so on. But the historical inanities, inaccuracies doesn't cover it, are unforgivable. I have no trouble with liberties being taken with historical material for dramatic purposes. But having Mounties chase rum runners in a country where rum is legal, depicting a trial where a jury is changed midstream, showing Eliot Ness tossing Frank Nitti off a building, the screenwriter displays a lack of respect, not just for history, but for his audience. Untouchable Life attracted a high school student from Michigan to the Des Moines Playhouse to see Michael Cornelison perform as Eliot Ness. A. Brad Schwartz had been a Dick Tracy fan since around 5 years of age, having been exposed to the film of that name, on which I was a creative consultant and wrote the movie tie-in novel. Just past age 11, and this may sound very familiar, Brad saw a movie called The Untouchables, recommended by his mother as being like Dick Tracy, but real life. He became enamored with that film, which led him to my work, including Road to Perdition, a graphic novel in which Eliot Ness appears. Brad was 15 the summer he came to Des Moines for the play Untouchable Life, going to the premiere of the film in Rock Island, Illinois, in February 2005. Somewhere along the way, we got to know each other, and while his college thesis evolved into the Orson Welles book Broadcast Hysteria, 2015, he suggested we collaborate on a biography of Eliot Ness. I'd had several editors suggest the same, but I felt Untouchable Life was my last word on the subject. Apparently, I was wrong. The project morphed into a dual biography of Capone and Ness. For a good long while, we hoped to follow Ness through to the end of his days, but eventually Chicago became the focus. For now. We hope to set the record straight on any number of things. The inaccurate and unfair portrayal of Ness is one. The glorification of Al Capone is another. Jonathan Eig, in his Get Capone, 2010, is guilty of both, particularly in trying to clear the mobster of the infamous baseball bat murders and the St. Valentine's Day massacre. For the former, Eig claims the baseball bat story dates only to 1975, when we have the basics in the Chicago Tribune and the New York Times within 2 days of the murders, and Capone wielding the bat himself in print within a year of the event. For the latter, Eig ignores ballistics evidence, eyewitness testimony, and a credible confession in favor of a convoluted theory based on a single, error-ridden letter to the FBI. Deidre Baer, in her book Al Capone, His Life, Legacy, and Legend, 2016, collaborates with Capone family members to present a portrait of a loving husband and father. Typically, Baer disparages Ness, claiming he made sure the press was there to take his photograph as he struck heroic poses over gallons of illegal booze being smashed to pieces and going down the drains and into the sewers. No such pictures exist. A handful of diligent researchers, among them Rebecca McFarland, Paul Heimel, and Scott Leeson-Schroka, have endeavored to shed light on the real Ness and his accomplishments. But even self-proclaimed Ness defender Douglas Perry, in Eliot Ness, The Rise and Fall of an American Hero, 2014, lingers on sordid details of Ness's supposed womanizing and drinking with little in the historical record to back him up. Filmmakers Ken Burns and Lynn Novick use Eig as a source for their documentary Prohibition, 2011, Novick insisting Eliot Ness had nothing to do with catching Al Capone. He wrote a book in which he just made stuff up. By dismissing Ness's work, Eig and others seek to shift the spotlight to the Treasury agents who compiled the tax evasion case against Capone. In particular, lead investigator Frank J. Wilson and his boss, Elmer L. Ire. The public has all but forgotten these men.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.